All right, I want to start out by introducing the president of the Cary Institute of Ecosystem Studies, Dr. Joshua Ginsberg, to welcome us all.
Good evening and welcome to the 11th Data Jam, Hudson Data Jam. For me, this is my 10th Data Jam because it started the year before I got to the Institute. And it's always a very special time of the year because it is a wonderful thing both to see how all of you have used the data that we have curated, but even more fun is how you have used art and music and stop action animation. And I can't go through all the different forms of artwork, but I am always impressed by the creativity and the diversity of what we do. As many of you know, because you've been engaged with Cary Institute, we're based in Millbrook, New York, and we don't have students at Cary Institute. So you guys are really special to us. So thank you for participating. And I hope you enjoy the show. And I'll let Alan and Becky take over from here.
Thank you, Josh. And I'd like to now introduce the head of education at Cary Institute, Alan Berkowitz.
Hey, folks, it's really great to be with you tonight or this evening. This is our 11th Data Jam. We're not the first Data Jam. The first Data Jam was the Desert Data Jam and started in 2012. Stephanie Besselmeyer at Las Cruces, the Desert Data Jam. We've had data jams in Baltimore. We have new set of data jams up in Massachusetts, the Northeast ecosystem. We have a great data jam happening in Luquillo, Puerto Rico. So we're part of a big data jam family. And in the spirit of data jam, all I'm going to do besides congratulate all the students and the mentors and the parents and the judges and the Cary Institute staff that supported data jam, I'm going to just give a short little song. We had kind of a little bit of a tradition. You did creative stuff, so we should do something creative. So I'm not going to do a whole long song about the data, but we're just going to do one verse. Data, 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 come and I want to go jump. Data, 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 come and I want to go jump. What kind of data do you kind of see? Data, come and I want to go jump. Creative projects for you and me. Data, come and I want to go jump. So data, 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 come and I want to go jump. Data, 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 come and I want to go jump. Take it over, Becky.
Thank you, Alan. Excellent. I'm Becky Van Tassel. I'm a education program leader at Cary, and I'm the one who's been emailing all of the advisors and visiting students and encouraging our judges to judge, and I'm really excited to have you all here. And the first thing I want to do is share the highlight reel of this year's projects. All right, here are your 2024 projects.
Don't blame me, we've been hearing lately about the human impacts in the Hudson River. All that has restored to its glory, so return it to the way it was forever. If I had a dime for every time I saw a piece of trash on the side and get a bit teary-eyed, something happened when I opened my eyes and it made me realize that we need to gather some allies. Ever since the 70s, the data hasn't been quite easy. And are we to blame? Have we really gone too far this time? Don't blame me, we've been here lately about the human impacts in the Hudson River. Lord, help us stop all of it together so our souls can feel as light as a feather. Don't blame me, we've been hearing lately about the human impacts in the Hudson River. Lord, help us restore it to its glory and return it to the way it was forever. Be
All right. I hope that gives you a taste of the incredible creativity and quality of the projects that we got this year. I couldn't be more impressed, as I always am, with what our students come up with for their projects. So, a little bit of data about Data Jam for you to give you some stats for this year's competition. We have been expanding our offerings of data sets, and this year students even went beyond that and collected their own data, found additional data sets from other sources. Overall, students used 32 different data sets in their projects, which means our judges had to understand 32 different sets of scientific phenomena in order to judge these projects. So here's the breakdown. As you can see, we have some data sets that are more exciting than others for students. And here are our top 10. And a note I wanted to say about these top 10 data sets is that our students and our advisors, you're really leaning in to the data sets that dive into global change topics and sociocultural and socioecological topics. You're really looking into these problems that are complex and deal with the human dimension and not just the ecological side. So kudos to you for students for tackling some of these really tough and complicated data sets. Yes, cheers. Whoopee. So what kind of projects did we get? As always, we got a huge array of different projects, as you saw in the highlight reel. But one of the things I noticed this year is that we had fewer videos than we've had in the past, and more students doing skits or musical songs or poems. People are really broadening their definitions of what we mean by creativity, which is just fantastic. And so here's just a smattering of all the different types of creative things we saw. And where are you all from? How many students do we have in the program this year? We had 12 different schools participate with 14 advisors. Some schools had more than one teacher leading classes of students through these projects. 50 judges participated in scoring all of these projects. Thank you, judges, for your scoring. We had 127 projects representing 295 students and their work. So that's just a wonderful number, and I'm so thrilled by our participation this year. Here's where you all are. We have sort of a split this year of some schools in the Mid-Hudson Valley and then lots of schools downstate. And I had the pleasure of traveling down to New York and meeting with some of our seasoned and every year participating advisors and some brand new advisors too. So that's where our students are hailing from. All right, so let's get down to the part that you've all been waiting for, the awarding of the prizes. So we have three categories to award prizes in tonight. We'll start with our youngest students in the Junior Data Jam. These are our fourth and fifth grade students, and we'll award an overall winner, runners-up, and honorable mentions in that category. Then we'll go to our middle school division, which has our largest number of participants, so we give away the most prizes in this category. And then we have our high school division, which we'll give an overall winner, runners-up, and honorable mentions for. And at the end, we have three special prizes to acknowledge the continued support and the new support of some of our sponsors for the program. All right, without further ado, let's get started. And please show your appreciation for these students and their work in the chat. When I finish with each division, we're going to come off mute and we're going to hoot and holler and clap and cheer and congratulate our winners. All right, in the Junior Data Jam competition, let's look at our honorable mention projects. From the Nest Plus M school, this is a new school participating this year down in New York City. We have Mari, Jenny, Sasha, and CJ for their project all about Lyme disease, and Natalie tracking the elevation of lead levels in children's blood. Congratulations.
Yeah.
Woohoo!
Woohoo! Yay!
Excellent hooting. Thank you. We also have, in our honorable mention category, Angel from Nest Plus M and Colin, Logan, May, and a classmate from Nest Plus M with their two projects, Rep Drought Data and Pollution Is Not the Solution. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Woo!
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 All right.
Thank you.
All right, our runners up. These were the projects that were very high quality and very close to getting the grand prize, but not quite there. Still wonderful projects were Elsa and Jesselyn and Layla from Nest Plus M. Congratulations.
Yay!
Yay!
I have to say, I spent a whole day at Nest Plus M with these students and their teacher, and it was wonderful to see their creativity already burbling to the surface when I was there, and to see the projects come through at the end is really special for me. So thank you for inviting me in. And now for our grand prize winner for the Junior Data Jam category goes to, are you ready? Aditya from Hudson Montessori, the big zebra mussel invasion. Congratulations.
Yay,
Congratulations.
And let's take a look at this project.
At a time, there were two little fishies, Bob and Rob. They loved eating and sleeping. Once, when it was time for dinner, they had their favorite meal. Zooplankton and phytoplankton. Yum, yum. They headed back to sleep on their favorite rock. Their favorite rock was called John. After they finished their meal, they went to go to sleep on the best rock ever, John. Once they got tucked in, they went to sleep. Once they woke up, they saw a boat was dropping zebra mussels on the sea floor. Those zebra mussels were invasive species coming from Europe. Some of those zebra mussels even landed on their favorite rock, John.
All right, let's give one more big round of applause for all our Junior Data Jam entries. Thank you so much. Well done.
Yay!
Okay, and now on to, oh no, we have to keep going, I'm sorry. All right, on to our biggest category, our middle school division. These are students grades 6 through 8. This is a tough category to score, I've got to tell you. Our middle school students are really honing their skills, especially the middle school students who've been participating in Junior Data Jam and now are participating in Hudson Data Jam. They really have some good Data Jam chops. So we tried to include as many projects as we could in this category, and there are so many good ones that we don't get to showcase tonight, but we just want to say that there's so many great projects in this category. So let's start with our honorable mentions. In this category, we're going to give prizes at each level. So level 1, level 2, level 3, which corresponds roughly to the difficulty of each of the sets of data that students were working with. So our honorable mentions for level 1, Piper, Isabella, and Charlotte from Marymount for Aquatic City, and Georgina and Maggie from Marymount for the cause and effect of rising temperatures in the Hudson River. Congratulations.
Yay! Yay, congratulations.
All right, and I think we have another honorable mention in this category are Ava Quigley and her classmate at Packer for A Tale of Two Hurricanes, Irene and Sandy, and Bobby Oakley and Trent from Packer for the BOT Explores the Hudson for level 2 honorable mentions. Congratulations.
That's so cool.
It is. There's flying fish in that diorama. Pretty awesome. All right, and we also have a third honorable mention for level 2, which was Josephine, Marguerite, and Winnie for A Tale of Migration and Friendship. See what she did there? Science pun. Well done, this team. Okay. For level 3 honorable mentions, we have Hannah and Eris from Packer Collegiate. How has the amount of elevated BLL changed over time and why? And Eleanor and Lucian from Marymount, turbidity and oxygen effects on primary productivity. Congratulations.
Way to go, Eris.
Woo! Okay, our level three honorable mentions continue with Liam and Stilo at Packer for paleobotany, Hudson Valley pollen from the Ice Age and beyond. We had to give them an honorable mention just for that hairdo. Well done, team.
Yay. Woo! Great job! Woo, great job!
Okay, so now time for our runners up for each level. Our runner up for level one was our student from Marymount who did a project called A Switch in Time Changes Lives. All right, our level two runners up, Avery, Jake, and Julian from Packer, keeping up with the muscles. All right, and our level three runners up, Taya and classmate from Packer, the Leafy Remains.
Woo! That was the best.
All right, and now for our winners for each level in the middle school category. Our level one winner goes to a student whose project investigated the impacts of invasive vegetation and created a game to teach players about aquatic ecosystems. That is Eleanor and her classmate at Speyer Legacy School called River of Invasives. Congratulations.
That is the best.
All right, our level two winner. This team looked at the relationship between rainfall and water quality during Hurricane Sandy, and they very effectively used Legos to animate changes in water quality. This team is Nixon, Kian, and Gray from Packer, the three building blocks of the Hudson. Congratulations. Woo! And we're gonna watch a little bit of this so you can see their Lego animation in action. Let's watch.
As Hurricane Sandy's rain falls into the Hudson, it creates lots of dissolved oxygen for the fish to breathe. In this stop motion, I'm going to explain how the rain of Hurricane Sandy creates a large amount of dissolved oxygen in the Hudson for its organisms to use. Due to Hurricane Sandy, it starts to rain and the clouds begin to turn dark. As the raindrop descends at a fast speed, it gets whipped with molecules of oxygen as they fall. As the raindrop splashes into the Hudson, it also forces those air molecules into the water as well. These air molecules then turn into dissolved oxygen and then are used by fish and other living organisms to breathe in the water. Because of all the rain Hurricane Sandy produces, there's an increase in the level of dissolved oxygen, or DO, in the Hudson River.
Thanks for making that video, team. Well done.
Let's see more.
All right, our level three winner, this team, used a mixed media stop animation to tell the story of bioaccumulation of PCBs in Hudson River fish. Level three winner is Fritz, Jasper, and Ben from Packer Collegiate, a look into PCBs and bioaccumulation in Hudson River fish. Congratulations. All right, and let's take a look at some of this awesome mixed media stop animation.
General Electric factories from 1947 to 1977.
Hi, I'm Chip the Channel Catfish.
Hi, I'm Stripey the Striped Bass.
Hi, I'm Perchy the Yellow Perch.
Hi, I'm Catty the White Catfish.
This is the story of fish in the Hudson River.
And that's our friend, Dr. Bullhead.
Hi.
Delicious.
Yum, my favorite meal. I do feel fatter, though.
That wasn't so delicious. I taste something bad. Something in the fat of my prey.
All right, congratulations to all of our middle school winners so far. Well done. And then we have one more grand prize for middle school. The project that blew us away most in the middle school category. These students dove into the complicated environmental justice issue of air pollution disproportionately impacting communities of color. The grand prize for middle school goes to Bethany, Avery, and Veronica for Robert Moses and his smoky impact. Congratulations. All right, let's take a look at Bethany, Avery, and Veronica's project.
Good morning and welcome back to New York One. Today, our topic is Robert Moses. Though he died 43 years ago, his legacy still remains in the unequal treatment of minorities. Look outside your window. Do you live near a highway or near an area where there are only one-way roads with few cars on the road? If you said the former, then you probably live in an area with a high minority percentage. The reason there are so many people who identify as minorities that live near big highways are because of people like Robert Moses. If you live near a big highway, you can thank him.
Robert Moses was known for constructing almost every highway in New York City. He was very intentional with where he put his highways, purposely putting them near places with a high minority percentage. When he was still alive, he believed that putting highways in areas with lots of minorities was the best way of making use of places he considered useless.
Oh my gosh, it's Fact Fairy Avery. Please tell us a fact.
Well, did you guys know that over 250,000 people were displaced from their homes because of Robert Moses?
Because of this, racism has been embedded in transportation. We tried to explain that in our creative component.
The houses you see displayed on the screen represent areas that are more suburban and are predominantly white. The apartment buildings that will soon be on the screen represent areas that are more urban and have more minorities. As our neighborhood becomes more urban, the amount of cars increases.
Because of him, we have an unbelievably high rate of asthma, cancer, and respiratory problems for people who identify as minorities. You may be thinking, what can I do to help? There's a few things you can do. One is to educate people in your community about the racial disparities in traffic and air pollution. Another is to reduce your carbon footprint by driving electric cars or taking public transport like trains and buses.
Woo! Congratulations, team. Well done. All right. Are we ready for our last category? Hudson Data Jam High School Division. These are students grades 9 through 12, and some of them have been doing Data Jam for quite a number of years and have produced some really exciting projects. So let's see who we have in our high school division. Our honorable mentions for the high school division go to Emma, April, and Aryan from Arlington for data analysis of the stream chemistry of the Wappinger Creek, and Alicia from Oakwood Friends blood lead levels of kids in Mid-Hudson Valley and New York City. Congratulations. Now for our runners-up for the high school category, we have Henry Cipriani from Oakwood Friends School, Factors That Influence the Hudson River's Estuary's Dissolved Oxygen Percentage, and Jae Hyun from Packer, Where Are All the Fish? Congratulations. Where are all the fish? It's a great question. All right, and now for our winner of the high school category. This team went above and beyond their data jam project. Not only did they find data through the DEC to study lake systems, they went out around New York City and collected their own water quality data to supplement their data set. They wrote a fantastic written report, which I wish you could read, and also created a wonderful game to challenge the user to learn about aquatic ecology. Our grand prize winner for high school goes to Sophia, Sammy, Ela, Elizabeth, Jackie, Alexis, Indy, and their classmate from Avenues, Drivers of Water Chemistry Variance Across New York City Lakes. Congratulations. Woo! Well done, team. Very much deserved. All right. And now we have our special awards. Let's not forget. Oh, sorry. This is the wonderful game that they sent me that I installed Python on my computer just so that I could play it. Thanks for sending me the file, Sophia. All right. Now for our special awards. We couldn't do Data Jam without our local sponsors from businesses, and many of them have been sponsors since the beginning of our competition. And so we have three awards this evening. The first is sponsored by M&T Bank for a Rising Young Scientist. And this award goes to Atharva from Hudson Montessori for the Ethical Dilemma of the 21st Century. Congratulations, Atharva.
Woo!
Yeah!
All right, and let's take a look at Atharva's project.
The Ethical Dilemma of the 21st Century by Atharva Agaskar. Enjoy.
Air pollution is a rising matter. We've got to take action and stop the chatter. It's caused by pollutants in vehicle exhaust. If we don't stop it, we will pay the cost. It's a rising issue in New York State. We gotta solve it fast, there's no time to wait. But I discovered that there's worse air quality in places with minorities. Where's the equality? Turns out there's something called environmental discrimination. It makes minorities and majorities live in separation. Factories and roads were built near minorities, and this was all planned out by the authorities. Air pollution and people, there's gotta be a correlation. The effect of an ethical dilemma in our nation. After a lot of research and a lot of writing, the observations start to become unexciting. There's more pollutants in places with those of color. The diesel particles make the places a lot duller. So how can we solve this large-scale complication? Well, get ready, because I've been known to have an imagination. I imagine a world free of air pollution. Just wait till you hear my practical solution. We should eliminate any unfairness and begin the creation of awareness. People should know the dangers of air contamination and how it is mostly affecting a certain population. By keeping houses away from highways and factories, children can play outside among the tall trees. Without a fear of ever getting sick, air pollution would be over, but it wouldn't be quick. If we want a world without air contamination, we would have to work hard without relaxation.
Thank you for watching, and I hope you enjoyed.
We sure did. Thank you for making that. Oh, God. All right, our rising young scientist. Our next special award is sponsored by Welsh Sanitation, a new sponsor this year. Thank you to Welsh for sponsoring the Budding Naturalist Award. And this award goes to Ginger and Amiko from Speyer Legacy for Raptor Migration. How will it change? This team used data on raptor migration and built this intricate wooden carved game with wooden pieces and beautiful game cards. It's a truly a work of art in addition to being a fun game to play. Congratulations.
Cool. Yes. Good.
Yay. All right, and our final award of the night, our final special award is the Central Hudson Powerfully Creative Award. And this award goes to a student who had a powerfully creative project. And that award is Empress Countess Annabelle and Kira from Nest Plus M for their fish and crab data wrap. And we're going to listen to it as our final project of the evening.
Fish and crab data is what we're learning about. Fish and crab data, all the facts are going down. Fish and crab data, yeah, I won't start. Instead of that, I'm learning by heart. Let's go. From M2015, we're looking at the data all out, full screen. Increasing number data, 2007. Call back, 2011. Salinity caused the fish to lower. In 2008, people turned to cold show. There was more disturbance to the batch. Only fishing trying to find the right catch. Removing fish from their patch. Like also, the fish won't let it go. Instead of here to show what they know. Vibing to the beat, so. When the fish is in the Hudson River, under pressure we will not shiver. All about here's what to know. Come on, crabs, let's run the show. When the fish is in the Hudson River, under pressure we will not shiver. All about here's what to know. Come on, crabs, let's run the show. Kicking it harder, we're digging deep. Salt levels rise, can you hear the fishes cry? No, this ain't no pattern. Climate change is the matter. Overfishing is stopping us too. People open their eyes, finally see the rise. All the fishes are nice guys. Would the fishing crab did to deserve this? How would you feel if you were fishing the surface? Suddenly need to change. Birds were useless cage. In 2011, all the efforts were in May. Many species of endangered fishing crab were saved. Singing high hands up in the air with wave. But glaciers started to melt. Another crisis to doubt. Research ended for the people to see. Drastic changes led up to be. Well, what happens next? Nobody knows. But for now, adios. When the fishies of the Hudson River, under pressure we will not shiver. All about here's what to know. Come on, crabs, let's run the show. When the fishies of the Hudson River.
All right, congratulations, Empress, Countess, Annabelle, and Kira. Well done. And that is all of the projects for tonight. I am so grateful to all of the students who put in hours and hours of time on their projects, and the time that you spent shows in the quality of the projects we got this year. I want to thank the advisors, teachers, parents, caregivers who helped their students through these projects, our judges for all the time they spent sorting through data sets and trying to understand the science so they could score these projects. We have an incredible intern with us at CARI this spring, Nafisa Rashid. A name you might recognize as a former Data Jam winner. She came back to us after finishing her undergraduate degree to intern this spring, and she's been a huge help with this project, along with the rest of the education staff. I have to thank our sponsors because they're the ones who are writing the checks to keep our program going, our broader CARI community, our Data Jam network that supports us, and everybody who joined tonight to show your support for the students and their very hard work. So thank you all for coming, and we'll see you for Data Jam 2026. Thank you.
25.
Yeah. Oh, 25, wrong year.
Well,
and 2026. Thank you, everybody.
Yeah.